Good morning and welcome to this webinar, a webinar in basic microphone training. My name is Ole Theilgaard. I'm Director for Global Support and Applications at Audio Precision and GRAS Sound and Vibration. I will be your presenter today and also hosting this webinar. The agenda for today's webinar is as follows. First, we will start with a little introduction. What is a microphone? We will also have a little introduction to the capacitor, introduction to microphone principles. We will have a look at externally and pre-polarized microphones. We will look at the design parameters, especially we will look at frequency range as well as dynamic range. When talking about measurement microphones, then we also have to have a little discussion about the standards. We have to look at the different sound fields in which we can use a measurement microphones. When we have talked about sound fields, then we will also start talking about the different types of measurement microphones available. And in the end, we will have a talk about venting. In the end of my presentations, then there will be some time for questions and answer. I will actually ask you to use the Q&A function in this team meeting. And then after the presentation, then I will go through all the questions there might be. Let's start. A microphone is a dynamic sensor measuring the pressure fluctuation in the media it is used in. Normally, the media is air. We all know that we are actually surrounded of a certain atmospheric pressure, and it is actually small pressure variation we will actually generate if we have a sound source. And these pressure fluctuation is actually the one we as human can pick up and hear. The microphone can actually do the same. It will also pick up these pressure variation or fluctuation, and then it will actually generate an electrical output. We could actually also call a microphone a converter for pressure to a voltage. So it will actually pick up the pressure fluctuation and give us a output voltage potential to the input pressure fluctuations. The maximum pressure fluctuation we can measure is, if we look at the theory about it, then it's actually the atmospheric pressure. So it means the maximum fluctuation we actually can see if we would like to have something symmetrically, then it's equal to today's atmospheric pressure. And it's about 1013 millibar, something in this neighborhood. And it means if we do the calculations, then we will actually end up with the maximum pressure we can measure is equal to 194 dB. Types of microphones. Yes, today's subject is measurement microphones, but there are actually different types of microphones on the market. And let's start with these microphones. First of all, we have studio microphones. Studio microphones are actually developed for giving us a subjective impression. They should have nice sound. They should have a nice design. Then there are some other microphones, communication microphones. All these microphones used in smartphones, tablets, and things like that, toys, many, many places. Today, actually, we have microphones. These microphones are produced in thousands and thousands and thousands and maybe millions. So they have actually normally a rather low price. But we also have to admit that these microphones have a very, very high reliability. Many of these microphones of communication microphones are today either digital microphones or analog microphones. The measurement microphones. The measurement microphones are actually used as a reference microphone quite often in combination with the two we talked about just before, studio microphones and communication microphones, for doing tests of a communication microphone, for doing tests of a studio microphone. Then very often you use a measurement microphone as a reference for doing these tests. It could be test of the frequency response, it could be test of the sensitivity and things like that. The measurement microphone is, like all the other microphones, a dynamic pressure. Is a sensor for measuring dynamic pressure in air. A measurement microphone is reliable. It will also give us a very accurate measurement. We have tighter tolerances for measurement microphones than we have for other types of microphones. A measurement microphone can actually be calibrated. A measurement microphone has to fulfill the IEC standard 61094. It is the standard for measurement microphones. A measurement microphone has a very high dynamic range. It has a frequency range covering the frequencies of interest. It is optimized for measurements in a specific sound field. It means it will have minimum influence to the sound field. A measurement microphone is also optimized to have a minimum influence on environmental changes. It will have minimum, if we change the temperature, then the sensitivity or frequency response of the microphone will actually not change. If we change the humidity, then we will see the same. If we change the static pressure, then we will see the same. So all these parameters will have a minimum influence on the performance of the microphone. A measurement microphone is designed to be used in heavy environment. So it has actually a robust design. Enough about measurement microphone for a half a minute. We will actually start looking at the capacitor. A capacitor is actually a component where we actually have consisting of two plates. And between these two plates, we have an insulator. This insulator can be made of plastic. It could be a special ceramic material. It could be many different material. When we are talking about microphones, then we use as this insulation material air. So it's an air capacitor. We you look at this capacitor, then we can actually start doing some calculations using the formula. So we can actually calculate the size of this capacitor, the capacity we actually have. And the size is actually the insulation material. It's called the electrical constant times the area of the plates. And then we divide it, and we will divide it with the distance between the two plates. It will actually give us the capacitor. If I make a little drawing of a microphone, then we can actually see that a microphone consists also of two plates, we could call them. It consists of a diaphragm. This is one of the plates, and the back plate of the microphone is the other plate. So the microphone do have exactly the same, and we have a certain distance between these plates. The distance between the plates in a microphone is 20 microns in this neighborhood. And the insulation material is air. Let's have a look on microphone principles. We have here the same drawing as we had before. And we can actually see that, yes, the microphone consists still of the diaphragm and the back plate. And here it's also mentioned that we have a diaphragm area with a certain diameter, and we have a distance between the plates, the diaphragm and the back plate. So it's here we have the capacitor. Actually, when we are looking at a measurement microphone, then it is actually a rather simple device, but very difficult to produce. I will come back to that. We can see it's a very simple device. It will only consist of a few components. It consists of the diaphragm itself. It consists of the back plate. We have talked about these two parts. And then it consists of the insulator material. And to keep all these things together, we have the housing around these three components. And to protect the diaphragm not to be broken, then we have a protection grid on the top of the microphone. So the microphone consists only of these, actually only of these five components. I told you it's difficult to produce, and it's actually due to the mechanical parameter we have here have to be very, very accurate, because the diaphragm will not move much. It will only move 0.0 something microns for a sound pressure level of 40 dB or something like that. So it is actually nothing, and therefore it is very, very important that we have the right height, that we have the right symmetric, and that the diaphragm and the backplate is 100% parallel with each other. So it makes it so expensive. We could actually look at an old drawing here of a microphone, and we can actually see, yes, it's almost the same components we have in this microphone. If we go back to how this microphone actually is working, then as I started telling you, that this microphone, a microphone will actually convert the pressure we have on the diaphragm to an electrical output, to a voltage output. So we have a pressure coming in at the diaphragm, and on the output we will measure an output voltage equal to the pressure we have on the diaphragm. If we look at this example here, we have some sound pressure at the diaphragm, and this sound pressure will actually change the distance between the diaphragm and the back plate. So we will change the difference, and it means that it's actually a variable capacitor we have made. So we have a variable capacitor controlled by the input pressure or the sound pressure, the pressure fluctuations we are going to measure. On the backplate is actually charged. We have actually charged the backplate with a high voltage. So we have a charge on the backplate. You can see here there's a BS voltage. In a standard measurement microphone, this BS voltage is around 200 volts. And on the next slides, then we will actually see why we actually will get an output voltage. But before we look at that, then we will talk about the two different measurement microphones we actually have. And it's actually externally polarized microphone and pre-polarized microphone. Let's start with the externally polarized microphone. The externally polarized microphone needs an externally BS voltage. It needs actually an externally 200 volt polarization voltage. This is a positive voltage. So we have actually a positive charge on our back plate. And it means if we have a positive pressure, if we have a positive pressure pulse coming, hitting the diaphragm, then the diaphragm will be closer to the back plate. If it's closer to the back plate, then the voltage at the back plate will be lower, and therefore the output will actually be a lower voltage output. So we will actually see that we have a 180 degrees phase shift between input, what we have on the diaphragm, and the output terminal of the microphone. Externally polarized microphones are also called traditional microphones or LEMO-type microphones. The LEMO-type microphones has actually something to do with the preamplifier we are using together with this microphone. We have to remember this microphone has to be used together with a preamplifier because the output impedance of this microphone is very, very high. So therefore, not to load the output of the microphone too much, then we have to have an amplifier very close to the microphone. So LEMO type is more related to the amplifier we are using together with this microphone. Pre-polarized microphones, let's have a closer look. They have an electrode layer. So we have actually what I call a built-in battery. So we have built in the BS voltage or the BS battery inside the microphone itself. We will come back to that. It means that we have no polarization voltage. We have no externally polarization voltage because it's actually internally. The electrode layer, it has actually been charged with electrons. An electron has a negative charge, so our polarization voltage inside the microphone capsule itself is actually negative charged. And it means if we have a positive pulse coming to the diaphragm, then we will also have a positive output of the microphone. So for a pre-priced microphone, we will not have a phase shift. So there's no phase shift. So we have the input phase is equal to the output. These microphones are also called CCP type or ICP type. And again, this has actually something to do with the preamplifier we are going to use with these microphones. It can either be a CCP or ICP preamplifier. It's actually the same word for the same principle. You can actually see the difference between an externally polarized and a pre-polarized microphone because the pre-polarized microphone has these two rings on the housing. Externally polarized microphone, they have a configuration which looks like the little drawing we have here. And it means we in a power module or a power supply have the 200 volt DC, our polarization voltage. In our amplifier, we have a 20 giga ohm resistor in serie with the 200 volt. This resistor would actually work as a constant current generator. Yeah, we have to remember that we have the positive charge here. If we look at a little formula, then the charge, the Coulomb Q, is actually equal to the capacitor times the polarization voltage. And this formula is actually valid for both externally and pre-polarized microphone. We look at the pre-polarized microphone, and if we have a closer look inside the microphone, then we will actually see that we have this electrode layer on our back plate. And it's actually in this electrode layer, we have it's this electrode layer we have charged with electrons. So we have actually made we could call it an artificial battery, which is placed directly on the back plate of the microphone. Yeah, the Teflon layer, electrode layer, charged with electrons, and it's negative charged. If we look here, then this one tells us how the microphone is working. If you remember the formula from before, that C is equal, or Q is equal with the voltage times the capacitance. And if we look at that, and we change it a little, so we isolate V, then V is equal to the charge divided by the capacitance. If we start this little film here, then we can see the diaphragm is moving. When the diaphragm is moving, then the distance, the H here, the distance between the plates will move. And when the distance between the plates will move, then the capacitor will actually change the capacity. And Q is always the same. It's a fixed value. So therefore, our output voltage will actually change according to how much the diaphragm is moving, how much the capacitor actually is changing. A difference, or the only difference between an externally and a pre-polarized microphone, is actually the upper dynamic range. And actually, it's only if it's mounted with a traditional amplifier when we are talking or limo amplifier when we are talking about the externally polarized, and with a CCP or ICP amplifier when we are talking about pre-polarized microphone. Else, I will actually say that a microphone, the parameter for an externally and a pre-polarized microphone is actually the same. You are able to measure almost the same over the same dynamic range. You have almost the same upper and lower dynamic figures. You have the same frequency range. You have the same coefficient, environmental coefficients, and things like that. So most of the data for an externally and a pre-polarized microphones are the same. But the most of the limitations is actually due to the preamplifier itself, and actually not the preamplifier, but it's actually due to the supply voltage to the preamplifier. If we have a limo or traditional microphone and we supply it with a 120 volt supply voltage, then we are actually able to use the whole dynamic range of the microphone. And therefore, we were actually able to measure rather high levels. On a pre-polarized microphone mounted on a CCP or ICP preamplifier, then we are actually limited by the supply voltage, which is about 28 volt, and then the useful range is about 14 volt. And due to this limitations, then the output voltage swing is actually limited. So it means that the upper dynamic range for a CCP microphone or a pre-polarized microphone mounted with a CCP amplifier is about 10 dB lower than it is for an externally polarized microphone with a supply voltage of 120 volt. If you use the same supply voltage for the limo ones and the CCP ones, then you will actually have the same upper dynamic range. Let's have a look at design parameters. Design parameters like frequency response and sensitivity. These two parameters we would like to get out of the microphone has actually something to do with the size of the microphone. It has something to do with the diaphragm, how we have made the diaphragm. It has something to do with the internal volume. With the internal volume, it means actually the volume you have behind the diaphragm and until the insulation wafer we have here. So it's actually this area we have here. The tension of the diaphragm. How tight have we actually made the diaphragm? How loose is the diaphragm? Things like that. The distance between the diaphragm and the backplate. The numbers of the holes in the backplate has also something to do with these things. Let's start with the size of the area of the diaphragm. large microphones. Microphones with a large diaphragm, bigger microphones, so to say, they have normally a very high sensitivity. When a microphone has a very high sensitivity, then it's actually able, then we are able, with this microphone, we are able to measure low levels. We are also able to measure relative lower frequencies. But due to the size of this microphone, then this microphone will actually disturb the field in which it is used more due to its size. So it will have more diffractions in the field. The smaller the microphone is, the lower sensitivity. I mean, a very small diaphragm, it is very difficult to get it up, to move this diaphragm. So therefore, the sensitivity is low. When the sensitivity is low, then it means that we can measure high level with this microphone. We can also measure high frequency or higher frequencies. And due to it's a very small microphone, then we will have less disturbance in the field, less diffractions in the sound field in which it is used. We can also actually see it on the picture here. The bigger the microphone is, the more it will actually disturb the field. If we compare this 1-inch microphone with the 1/8 inch here, then we can actually see that the little one here will not disturb the same as the bigger one will. Design parameter, we can actually look at design parameter from the mechanical equivalent of the microphone. We can actually describe the microphone as a single degrees of a vibrating system. It means that we can actually describe the diaphragm and its mass as the mass in a vibration system. We can describe the diaphragm tension as a spring in this vibrating system. We can describe the damping, the system damping from the backplate, actually the numbers of holes in the backplate. When we design a microphone at GRAS, then we are actually looking at these parameters, and then we are using these parameters for designing the microphone. If we would have, if we would like to have a small microphone able to measure very, very, very high signals, then we might have a microphone with a very high mass of the diaphragm. So it will actually be a thick diaphragm we are using. We will probably also have a diaphragm with a very, very high tension. So by playing with these two, then we will actually be able to measure very high levels. If we would like to measure very low levels, then we have to make the diaphragm as small, or as the mass of the diaphragm as small as possible. So we will probably use a very thin diaphragm. And then we will have less tension of the diaphragm. So the diaphragm is very, very easy to move. Let's have a look on these different parameters. Let's have a look at the influence of damping. The damping is more or less controlled by the backplate. You can see here a backplate with a lot of holes inside. And it's actually done so the diaphragm it's easier for the diaphragm to move. We have no resistance when the diaphragm would like to move. So the influence of the damping is actually controlled by the numbers of holes in the back plate plus the volume, how big the volume, the back volume is. Actually, this volume we have here, how big it is. You can actually have microphones the same size of microphone, but the height of the housing might be different. And it's actually due to we need different back volumes to get different sensitivity of the microphone. So by this, if the back volume is small, then the whole system will be more stiff, and we won't have a huge damping of the system. So the bigger it is, the more damping, and therefore we will be able to measure higher levels. Also, we will have higher sensitivity. If we look at the influence of the diaphragm's tension, then the softer the tension is, the higher sensitivity, and then the resonance frequency will actually also be lower. The more stiff the tension is, then the less sensitivity we will have, and then we will also move up the resonance frequency at higher frequencies. It's actually very similar to what we actually have on a drum, and where we lose diaphragm of the drum, will give we will be able to measure or play very low frequency, but not so much in the high end and the opposite way. The influence of the diaphragm mass, the higher mass will give us a lower frequency response, and the looser mass than the other way around. If we look at frequency response, then we're actually talking about a lower frequency limit, and it's actually the lowest frequency we can measure with the microphone. It's normally specified at -2 dB or -3 dB. In the other end, we have upper frequency limit, the highest frequency we can measure, and this is also specified at -2 or -3 dB. At GRAS, we have actually the microphones measuring for 0.09 Hertz up to 140 kilohertz. It's not the same microphone, but we have microphones in that can measure in this range. We look at the dynamic range of a microphone. Then then we are talking about the lower limit of dynamic range. It is actually also called inherent noise, or the noise floor, the self noise of the microphone. This, the lower limit of dynamic range, is specified in dBA, and it will actually be in the neighborhood from 16 dBA up to 50 dBA for standard half inch, quarter inch, and 1/8 inch microphones. At the other end, the max we can measure with the microphone, it is called the upper limit of dynamic range, the maximum level. This level is specified in dB peak. And for a half inch microphone, we are going from about 136 dB and up, quarter inch up to 184 dB, and 1/8 of an inch up to 174 dB. And then there are some microphones, special microphones, where so it's actually possible to measure lower or higher signals. Typically, the dynamic range, the difference between the upper and the lower dynamic range, is called the microphone's dynamic range, and it's typically 120 dB. At GRAS, we have actually microphones. We have some microphones called low noise microphones. These microphones can actually measure down to minus 2 dB, actually below threshold of hearing. And we have also microphone in the other end measuring up to 193 dB. The standard for measurement microphone. The standard for measurement microphone is the IEC 61094 standard. It consists, this standard consists of totally 8 chapters or parts. The most important when we are talking measurement microphone is part 1, the one called specifications, and part 4, the one called specifications for working standard microphones. The one called part 1 specifications is actually the specifications for a laboratory standard microphone, while the other one is the specification for a working standard microphone. All the GRAS microphones or the GRAS measurement microphones, they are actually fulfilling either the IEC 61094, that's one. It's our laboratory microphones, and all the IEC 61094, that's four, the specification for a working standard microphone. The standard here, the IEC standard here, the IEC 61094, does not deal with class 1 or class 2, and nor with type 0, type 1, type 2, or type 3. These classifications, class 1 or 2, and types, they are actually classification and specifications described in the sound level meter, described for sound level meter and the sound level meter standard IEC 61062. This standard is dealing with classes, or in the old sound level meter standard IEC 60651. This standard deals with types. And we also have to have in mind that if somebody talks about either a type 1 or 2 or 3 microphone or a class 1 or 2 microphone, then we are actually talking about a half-inch free-fill microphone, normally for sound level meter measurement. If we look at the standard, then the standard actually describes a lot of parameter, a lot of specifications we have to fulfill to be able to call the microphone a working standard microphone or a laboratory standard microphone. It is actually specifications such as sensitivity, frequency response, dynamic range, the size, environmental parameter such as static pressure, temperature and humidity, and also long and short term stability. LS2P, it means actually laboratory standard, half inch, the 2 is half inch and P is for pressure microphones. We have one microphone fulfilling this standard, and it's actually our laboratory reference microphones, the 40AU, that's one. This microphone fulfill all the specifications written in the standard in the IEC 61094, that's one. WS means working standard, one for 1 inch microphones, and P for pressure. And the next one, WS2, is for half inch microphone, P for pressure, F for free fill, and D for diffuse fill. Working standard 3 is for quarter inch microphone, and P and F and D for pressure, free fill, and diffuse fill. Working standard microphones, and it's actually all the GRAS microphones, all the GRAS 1-inch microphones, half-inch, and quarter-inch microphones are actually fulfilling this standard. The 1/8 of an inch microphone are actually not described in the standard, but we have actually, all our specifications are actually made according to the standard. So we have exactly the same set of specifications for our 1/8 inch microphone as we have for all the other sizes of microphones. Sound fields. See, when we use a microphone in a sound field, when we have a sound source like the one we have here on our slide, and we place a microphone in front of it and start measuring, then we will actually see if we have placed the microphone very, very close to the sound source, then we will measure one level. And if we move it just a little away from the sound source, a millimeter or so, then we will actually see that we will still measure the same. We call this the near field. And as long as we are in the near field, then we will actually measure the same. At a certain distance from our sound source, then we will actually see that when we move the microphone the double distance as it was before from the source, then it will actually drop the level with 60 dB. And every time we do this, then it will drop it with 60 dB. As long as this is dropping by 60 dB, then we are in the free field. At a certain point, if we are in a room, let's say that, then we will be very close to the walls, and then we will start having some reflections from the walls. If we have reflection from the walls, then we will actually, then we won't see the 60 dB any longer, but we will actually again see that we will approximately measure the same, the closer we actually will get to the wall. It is actually called the relevant field. So totally we have the near field where we are closing, where we are measuring very, very close to the source. Then we have the far field when we are away from the source. The transition point between near field and far field is typically a 1/4 of the longest wavelength of the frequency wavelength. And typically the transition between free field and the reverberation field is typically where we have 6 to 10 dB higher than the reflecting sound. A description of near field, free field, far field, and reverberation field. If we have a microphone, and again, we place this microphone in front of a sound source, then at low frequency where we have long, long wavelengths, then these low frequencies, these long wavelengths, they will not be disturbed by the microphone itself, because the microphone is so small compared to the wavelength. If we take a 100 hertz tone, low frequency, then the wavelength is 3.4 meter. And if we have placed a little microphone, half inch microphone, then the diameter of the half inch microphone is equal to 1.3 centimeter. So 1.3 centimeter compared with 3.4 meter, yeah, it will not disturb. But at higher frequencies, then the wavelength will be shorter and shorter and shorter. So at higher frequencies, let's say 10 kilohertz, then the wavelength is equal to 3.4 centimeter. Then this little microphone with only 1.3 centimeter, it will actually have a certain impact in the field, and it will actually start making disruption of the field. We will actually have a pressure build up in front of the diaphragm of the microphone. So the microphone with at these higher frequency measure a higher level. We can also see it here on this small video. Low frequency, it will not disturb the microphone, but a higher frequency, it will disturb the microphone. We can actually see this pressure built up in front of the diaphragm. If we have what we call a free-field microphone, it's actually a microphone where we actually are pointing at the sound source, pointing at where the sound is coming from, pointing at the speaker, so to say. So we are pointing what we call with a 0 degrees of incidence to the speaker. We still have to remember that the diaphragm or the diameter of the half inch microphone is 1.3 centimeter. And we can actually see here at low frequency, then nothing will happen. We will not disturb the field, but the higher the frequency is, then we will actually start disturbing the field and we will measure higher and higher levels. And it's actually due to the microphone will actually have more and more and more impact in the field due to its size. You can actually see here frequencies and wavelengths, 20 kilohertz, 1.7 centimeter in wavelength, and the microphone 1.3 centimeter. So the microphone will actually disturb quite a lot at 20 kilohertz. We don't want the microphone to disturb. So if we actually use the microphone in an angle of 90 degrees incidence and do the measurements, then we can actually see that we will not disturb the field like that. We will not have any pressure built up in front of the diaphragm. So when the microphone is in a 90 degrees angle to the sound source, then we will have this blue line, almost a flat response. Why? If we are pointing directly at the source in 0 degrees, then we will have the gray line here. It's difficult to see, but we will have the gray line, which actually will disturb. We can see how much we are disturbing the field. This is actually the same for both half inch and quarter inch microphones. A half inch microphone will, of course, due to it's bigger than the quarter inch microphone, disturb at lower frequency, between 10 and 20k, while the quarter inch, the influence of the quarter inch microphone will happen at much higher frequencies, as long as we are pointing at the source. It will actually tells us that we actually have different types of microphones. We have free-field microphones. A free-field microphone is made and optimized to be used in a free-field. And it means that the pressure buildup we have in front of the diaphragm at the higher frequency, we actually, in the production, will actually compensate for this. So the frequency response of a free-field microphone when used in a free field is as flat as possible. A free-field microphone is also known as an omnidirectional microphone. Let's have a look at the free-field microphone, actually how we make it. We have seen on the previous slides that we will, due to the size of the microphone, then we will actually see this pressure build up in front of the microphone. So it is actually this, the blue line here, the blue curve. So we will have this pressure build up in front of the microphone when the microphone is pointing directly at the source. At the factory, we will actually adjust what we call the pressure response of that microphone. So according to the black line here. So if you look at the black line, then it's minus and the blue line is plus, and they have approximately the same minus and plus. So if we look at the difference between these two lines, is actually the red one here is actually called the final free-field response. So this is the red curve is actually what we will measure in the free field with a microphone produced in this way. So we are actually in this way compensating for the pressure buildup by make the pressure response for the microphone starting falling off a little bit earlier. So the free field response is actually equal to the pressure response of the microphone plus the free field corrections. A pressure microphone is designed to measure the pressure that exists in front of the microphone diaphragm. It could be in a situation like here where we have mounted the microphone in a wall. It could also be in situation where we have mounted the microphones in small cavities, or the microphone is thrust mounted. It could be on an aircraft wings, etc., for measuring the pressure fluctuations we have over the surface. A pressure microphone is optimized to have a flat as possible response, frequency response, when it's used in a pressure field. We see the response here. It's very, very flat. We also have, we also have something called random incidence microphones or diffuse field microphones. These microphones are actually optimized to measure sounds coming from many directions. We are using a random incidence microphones in situations where we don't know where the sources are. If we have a room and we don't know where the different sources are located, so we can't point directly at a source, then we are actually using a random incidence microphone. The random incidence microphone, is exactly the same way as a free field microphone. We have the influence of the sound field is the blue line where we have the pressure build up. Then we have the factory adjusted pressure response. And then we have actually the finally random incidence response, the black curve here. Where to use these different microphones? For standard sound level measurements, we will normally use a free field microphone. If we are in Europe, Asia, many of you here today, this morning, are actually from America. So you will probably use a random incidence microphone because you would like to measure according to the ANSI standard. So in US, you are using a random incidence microphone for these purposes. In the rest of the world, most of us would actually use a free-field microphone. A free-field microphone is also used for environmental measurements. airport noise measurement and things like that, also for general noise measurements. A pressure microphone is used in small cavities like couplers, ear simulators, and things like that. It's also used if the microphone is mounted on a structure for measuring pressure fluctuations over the structure. If we would like to measure in cabins or reverberation rooms, then we will normally use a random incident microphone. As we started with in this webinar, we actually started with defining what we actually are measuring with the microphone, and it is a pressure fluctuation in the media it is used, normally air. But we also have to remember that we have this atmospheric pressure. So we should actually be able with the microphone to compensate for the atmospheric pressure. So we aren't looking or measuring the atmospheric pressure as well. So therefore we have a venting system in the microphone. So we actually have the same atmospheric pressure in front of the diaphragm as we have behind the diaphragm. So there's a little hole in the microphone. Normally there's a hole between the little closed cavity we have behind the diaphragm. That's a little hole. And we also have a hole in the preamplifier, so we can actually have the air going from the hole in the preamplifier into the back volume of the microphone. So we are venting via this hole. This is what we call a rear venting, when the microphone is venting to the back. We also have something called a front vented microphone. A front vented microphone is when the microphone is venting to the front, and it means we have a little hole in the side of the microphone capsule close to the front of the microphone. Where to use front and rear vented microphone? Where to use front vented microphone? A front vented microphone must be used if there are a huge, or if there are a difference in the static pressure between the front of the microphone and the back of the microphone. In situations like wind tunnel applications or application where the microphone is used in a closed cavity box, etc., and the microphone is actually placed in the wall between inside the box and outside the box. In these cases, we might have a huge static pressure difference between front and back. Use of rear-vented microphone. A rear-vented microphone should actually be used if there are no difference in the static pressure between the front and the back of the microphone. And it is actually in most measurement situations. Static pressure equalization. See, I have a microphone here. And I will start blocking the venting hole of this microphone. So this microphone can't vent. It's not venting. So if I move this microphone in a height of 1 meter, we have no venting. If I move it 1 meter up and down, then it is actually the same as we have changed the atmospheric pressure with 0.033 millibar. This is equal to 3.3 Pascal. Again, if we calculate it into sounds, then it's actually equal to 140 B. So if we have plugged the venting hole in the microphone, then and we move it up and down 1 meter, And it's actually the same as a sound pressure level of 140 dB. So yeah, that's a calculation. It is actually very important to remember when you are mounting your microphone, then don't plug the venting hole. Because if you plug the venting hole, then you will have wrong measurements. You will overload the microphone. You will overload your preamplifier. And it will normally happening at lower frequencies. So when you mount your microphone, then be careful not to plug for the venting. The venting is actually also doing something else. It is actually controlling the acoustical cutoff frequency of the microphone capsule. So the smaller the venting hole is, the lower cutoff frequency. And the larger the venting hole is, the higher cutoff frequency. This can also be described as a simple RC network. We have the formula here. We have also another cutoff of the microphone and the preamplifier, and it's the electrical cutoff. It's actually when we mount the microphone on the preamplifier, then the preamplifier has an input resistance, and we have the microphone capsule, and this input resistance and capsule will actually generate a high pass filter, actually a low frequency cutoff of the combined unit, the microphone and the preamplifier. So the cutoff frequency of the microphone is actually depending on the electrical cutoff as well as the acoustical cutoff. So it's a combination of these two cutoffs. A little about challenges. If we could make the biggest microphone in the world, actually as big as the Urch, then this microphone will have a diameter of 12,756 kilometers. It will have a thickness of 2 kilometers. It will have a distance between the diaphragm and the back plate of 20 kilometers. As described here. If we have this microphone, as we saw in the beginning, 2 kilometers, 20 kilometers in the distance between the back plate and the diaphragm. If we apply a signal of 40 dB, if we have a sound source creating a noise of 40 dB, it is actually the same as we have in a very silent living room back home. Then the movement of this diaphragm, there are 2 kilometers thick, is 10 millimeter. If we apply other levels, then of course the diaphragm or the movement of the diaphragm will actually be more or less. So we will actually move this microphone diaphragm from 1 millimeter up to 10 kilometers for covering the whole dynamic range of this microphone. It's quite a lot. If you take your calculator and divide all the numbers here with 100 millions, then you will actually have the actual data for a half inch microphone. So you can actually see at 40 dB, then it's not many microns the diaphragm is moving for giving us this output and sound pressure level. This was actually all. And now we will go to questions, questions about the capacitor. Questions about microphone principles, externally and pre-polarized, yeah, all the subjects we have been through. So I will switch to the question and answering sections. And see what we can find here. I can't see anything yet. I will give you a couple of minutes if you have any questions. I'll take some water. I don't think there are any questions. If you have a question, then please feel free to contact us at support@grasacoustics.com, and we will answer your questions. We have a webinar later this month, actually on the 29th of September. This webinar will cover the subject acoustical test of laptops and tablets, PCs. And yeah, you are very, very welcome to participate in this webinar as well. I will go back to see if there are any questions. And no, it's not the case. Okay, I will say thank you. Thank you for participating. And we do hope to see you next time. I will wish you a very nice day, and for some of you, a nice evening. So, goodbye and thank you.
Find out more at Vicom's website.